children. We are excited to see you all today. And even if we're still by Zoom, but we are delighted to have one of our most popular and exciting speakers join us today. And that is Jessica Shore from Encompass Tutorial. And she's going to discuss a hot issue, which is executive function. One of the key points that we all have in trying to help our kids figure out how to navigate their way, how to develop that prefrontal cortex and all of the different issues that come with that. And so we will, just a reminder, we are recording our session. And so please make sure if you ask any questions during the session while we're recording that this is information that you are comfortable having shared on the web, because all of our recordings are posted online afterwards at Laura's library, actually West Bank Library, under their video section. Laura's is a part of West Bank Library. And so we will be having that posted up there. So please make sure any information that you share today on the recorded session is shareable in the long term. We will have a Q&A at the end, at which time we turn off the recording and people can share more information that they might feel more comfortable with at that point. Folks are invited to ask any quick questions that they might have during the presentation. You can do that through the chat box. If there's any clarification or anything like that you want to know, but if you want to get into longer stories and whatnot, we ask that you please hold off and do that at the end. I want to make sure that I talk a little bit more about what we're going to do today. We're going to walk through executive functioning, which is, as we've mentioned, one of the hot button issues for developing children and an understanding of kids do well when they can, right? When they have lagging skills and issues that they're struggling with, you know, they're trying to figure this stuff out, but it's not necessarily intrinsic to so many of us. These are skills and skills need to be built. So Jessica Shore founded Encompass Tutorial Services as an initiative to address the needs of a different value system in education. She's helped countless students develop the executive functioning skills that allow them to better navigate the classroom, feel more confident, and manage stress. Something we all need to do, especially these days. Her focus is on bridging connections between the ways we think and feel about ourselves and the way we engage with the environments around us. She firmly believes that in developing strong executive functioning skills, students with all needs will have less stress and more confidence within and outside of the classroom. I agree wholeheartedly. And in addition, Jessica is working on some collaborative workshops that they run on Wednesdays. She'll start up another one. They are several sessions with families in their group workshop on Wednesdays from 6 to 7:30, and they will start up another session. The current session that's ongoing is full. The next session will start after spring break, but you can contact Jessica to find out more information about that. And I think that covers everything that we have, but I want to welcome you all here. Thank you for being here. And without further ado, I will send you to Jessica Shore.
Great. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. Okay, and start presenting. So thank you, Denise, so much. I'm so excited to be here again and to talk to all of you. So as she said, I am the founder and director of Encompass, and I've been doing this a very long time. But my path here was kind of windy. So I grew up in the Dallas area and then went to college at the University of Pennsylvania. And I was one of those crazy people that wanted to be a high school history teacher and was really excited about it and did do that for quite some time. And then took it a little far and ended up getting a master's and PhD in ancient and medieval history at UT Austin. And while I was at UT, I was able to teach there for about 4.5 years. I've taught at ACC. Like I said, I've worked in the high school arena. And I just kept noticing this trend that was very overwhelming, that so many of my students were bright and cool and awesome and funny and creative and had all of these interests and were motivated to be successful. I mean, we're talking about UT students, Plan 2 students. But where they really struggled was their ability to get their work in on time, to show up prepared, to self-advocate. And it just seemed like there was a resource that wasn't available to them at the time, or wasn't really able to properly name the issue in order to find the right solution. And it was in working with those students, you know, I was happy to teach them about the Roman Empire, but that led me in this path to create Encompass to meet, you know, as Denise said, a different need within our education arena. So here's what I would love to do today. I'd love to talk to you about just executive functioning in general. What is it? How does it relate to ADHD? How does it relate to anxiety? And really just impact all of us. I then want to spend some time talking about motivation. Again, what is it? And how do we prevent those motivation breakdowns? I then want to talk about the teenage brain, because while executive functioning affects all of us at any stage of life, that teenage brain is unique. So I want to spend some time talking about how that's going to play a role. And then, of course, at the end, just spend some time talking about actionable things that you as parents can do to support your children's executive functioning. You know, I do imagine this is going to raise a lot of questions, as Denise said. So please feel free to chime in. I'll hopefully be able to see that in the chat, but I will be taking questions at the end and look forward to it. Okay, let's get started. So what the heck is executive functioning? I mean, to be honest, I feel like it's popping up everywhere nowadays, but it wasn't around when I was growing up. It wasn't around when I was training to be an educator. I feel like we're all just kind of trying to figure out what does it mean, but we know it's important. So there are many ways to understand executive functioning. We can talk about it cognitively and neuropathically and behaviorally, but at Encompass, we most simply define it as our ability to execute and function to meet tasks and responsibilities. And here's the key part, strategically with low stress. This means that we're more in control of our experiences and not just that scramble to get things done. You know, right now, you know, as parents, your children, we're observing them, their tasks and responsibilities are gonna be somewhat limited to the academic arena. This means they need to get their work in on time, show up prepared, participate in the classroom, ask for help, keep track of everything to get it done. So we're going to spend today talking about executive functioning academically, because that's their tasks and responsibilities. But as they get older, those tasks and responsibilities are going to become more diverse, more complex. You know, so we have a young adult program for people 18 to like 25, because that stage of life requires a whole different subset of tasks and responsibilities. We also have an adult program because, as we all know, as adults, we have a whole different set of tasks and responsibilities. But what remains the same, what's pervasive, are the executive functioning skills that we need to meet those tasks and responsibilities strategically with confidence. So that is the way we manage our time, organize, prioritize, self-advocate, goal set. These are the skills, again, I'm being a bit repetitive, but that are pervasive, but that are not intuitive to so many people. So, excuse me one second. So going back to the academic arena, when we don't intuitively have these skill sets, the symptom or the fallout of low executive functioning tends to be late and missing work, disorganization and lost work, inconsistent or lowered grades, inconsistent or lowered motivation, and difficulty asking for help or utilizing resources. Those are symptoms. So we at Encompass want to mitigate those symptoms by teaching those skills and putting systems in place to reinforce those skills. So with time management, with organization, with study strategies and goal setting and self-advocacy skills, which are skills, we help reduce all of these symptoms to create a more positive academic experience. But here's what's interesting. Not every person who struggles with low executive functioning necessarily has ADHD or anxiety. Not at all. But almost, I mean, it's kind of guaranteed that every person with an ADHD diagnosis, particularly an inattentive or mixed diagnosis, is going to show symptoms of low executive functioning. Executive functioning skills are not going to be innate or intuitive. And that in turn increases anxiety. So why are ADHD, anxiety, and executive functioning so closely intertwined? I almost want you to think about them as, to some extent, symptomatically synonymous. This is because the brain chemistry of a person with ADHD is designed in such a way, and there's a lot behind this, so just kind of believe me when I say it's just not intuitive. It's just not going to be natural, again, to hold multiple tasks at once and to put strategies in place to meet those multiple tasks. So people genuinely struggle in that arena. And then what happens is we have these bad habits that get put in place. We're like, just, again, that disorganization, that mismanaged time. And the more we get into that routine, even though it's an unhealthy routine, the harder it is to change. So it's almost like low executive functioning begets low executive functioning. And I think as adults, we can all relate to that. Like, I've been doing this so long and I know it doesn't work, but it's what's comfortable. To make matters worse, and this is, I think, particularly true of our children, when we are told, and we are told from an incredibly young age, that we should just be able to keep track of everything on our plate, to be able to get it done, to ask for help. You should just know how to do that. And when we can't do that, it makes us feel shame or anxiety or insecurity that something's wrong with us. And so it's almost that the ADHD and the low executive functioning reinforce anxiety. And anxiety, as we're going to learn a lot about today, the higher our anxiety, the lower our functioning. So they just work in this cyclical tandem to reinforce each other. To get a little more specific about that ADHD brain, one of the biggest symptoms of ADHD that makes executive functioning difficult is something called object permanence. You might have heard of it with like babies when you play peekaboo, that like they actually think you've disappeared. It's kind of the same concept. It just simply means out of sight, out of mind. If I don't see it, perceive it, or sense it, it doesn't exist for me. So that assignment, my planner, if it's not in my view, I'm not thinking about it. This makes it extremely difficult to hold multiple tasks at once. So maybe they're thinking about that math assignment, but while they're thinking about that math assignment, they can't think about the English and the history or the permission slip they needed to sign. It's like, I'm just focused on this one thing and nothing else exists. It similarly makes it really hard to keep track of materials. It's like, once it's in the backpack, this is like kind of true of the planner and why routines around planners and organization systems are so difficult. Once it's in there, I forgot about it and I don't know where I put it and I'm not thinking about it. And it's like, I know I should use my planner, but once it's out of my sight, it's out of my mind. It also makes people with ADHD really prone to messiness and disorganization. So kind of commonly, you'll see people, like I think we all probably had this with online learning and COVID, where they're like zoomed in and they're not seeing all of the mess around them, but you can see it. And they're like, oh, I don't even think about it because of that tunnel vision with object permanence. So it makes it really hard to kind of basically execute and function in a healthy way. The next big symptom of ADHD that makes executive functioning particularly challenging is something called rigid and binary thinking. This is black or white, good or bad, all or nothing thinking. That's that kind of binary component of it. And then the rigidity piece means we get stuck. Once I feel this way, this is how I feel. I'm either good at this or I'm bad at this. And it really affects the way that we think about ourselves, and it affects the way that we think about our work. So when it comes to the way that we think about ourselves, it can really impact our self-esteem because we're thinking in these binary ways. I'm a success or I'm a failure. I'm good, I'm bad, I'm smart, I'm stupid. And often it's not very rational because, again, we're dealing with a teenage brain, but they have one experience that triggers this negative feeling or self-identifier, and then we get stuck in it. I'm bad at math. I'm good at this. It's difficult to build healthy senses of self-esteem when we have rigid and binary thinking. When it comes to the way that we think about our work, this is more that pragmatic piece of executive functioning. So the way we engage with our work, organize, manage our time, or prioritize gets very rigid. So it almost looks like this. I have any homework. Homework feels like a lot and it's overwhelming. I don't want to do homework. I have homework or I don't have homework. I'm going to work or I'm not going to work. It makes it very hard to break down that thinking so that it feels more manageable and easier to engage. Okay, so that's a lot about how ADHD really affects our ability to execute and function. Or I would say those are the two most primary ways. There's a lot of other ways. But I think what this is leading to is, how do we just engage with our work? Like, how do we motivate ourselves if we have these deficits? And as parents, how do we prevent these motivation breakdowns? I often find that this is the most critical piece because this is like, why won't they just do their work? It would be so much easier if they could just do it. To start, motivation is the desire to act in service of a goal. It is the crucial element in setting and attaining our objectives. At Encompass, we feel that there are kind of three factors, three pillars that really greatly like increase our motivation or plummet our motivation. The first is value. This is the why behind why we do what we do. The second is environment. Where, when, and how we work. Again, that's the more pragmatic executive functioning piece. And then probably most critically, our thoughts and our feelings. Okay, to jump in. If motivation is the desire to act in service of a goal, then we need to be aware of our goals, the value of the work. This is what we call a metric of success. Excuse me, one second. The issue with value and motivation, particularly for teenagers, is that it requires the self-awareness to know these things and kind of the fortitude to not negotiate these value systems. But the two kinds of value systems that exist are intrinsic. How I feel. Do I find the work interesting? Do I get something out of it? Do I feel a sense of pride around this work? Or extrinsic, which is more common. I want the grade. I don't want to embarrass myself in class, or I want teacher approval. I want parent approval, or more commonly, privileges. I don't want to get in trouble with my parents. And most teenagers, like when we assess them, they'll be like, oh, it's boring and I don't want to do it. That's some identification of intrinsic. But a lot of times it's very difficult for teenagers to have that level of self-awareness. So intrinsic value, maybe it drives some of the show, but it's not enough to keep people completely consistently motivated. And most teenagers negotiate the extrinsic value of an assignment. It's like, I know I should do my math homework, but it's boring, intrinsic value. And it won't really matter all that much if it's a day late, grade-wise, extrinsic value. And so there's a lot of inconsistency there. It's for that reason that our work at Encompass and what I'm going to encourage you guys at home to do is to really help define those metrics of success to increase motivation. Oh, environment. And I think all of us who parented during COVID are so aware of like screens and video games and TikTok and friends, and it's important to see friends, but environment has just been a huge part of our experiences in the last 2 years. And I think it's affected everybody's motivation. So this speaks to our physical space and at-home routines, and then pragmatic strategies. So I think reducing messy spaces and clutter, regulating distractions and minimizing interruptions. The executive functioning piece more traditionally is what I'm going to do, when, in what order, for how long. And while it might seem that that's sort of basics, like, okay, yeah, you got to know that and you should just know that. For people with ADHD and anxiety, those are all micro decisions that are very difficult, that increase anxiety and cause decision fatigue. So it's just easier to just not do it. So we want to make sure that we have the right environment and we have these strategies in place, so it's just easier to engage. Lastly, our thoughts and feelings. So it's important to recognize that it's a universal truth that we are inclined to turn away from the things that make us uncomfortable, overwhelmed, insecure, anxious, uncertain about our approval, uncertain about our future. It's like, oh my gosh, I don't want to do those things. Those feel terrible. So our thoughts and feelings really affect our ability to engage with our work. So, kind of in summary, we have values, we have environment, we have feelings, and they're not mutually exclusive. In fact, they kind of waterfall into each other to really affect our ability to be motivated. So not knowing how and why we're supposed to do the things that we're supposed to do exacerbates our anxiety and stress. Anxiety and stress can lead us to negotiate our values. It's like, oh, I don't want to do that. It's not that important anyway. And honestly, having some pretty yummy distractions can make it easy for us to negotiate value. It's like, yeah, I think I'd just rather play video games than do that stressful assignment. So they all work together to either increase or decrease motivation. This is why so many students will negotiate that value of the work, don't have the routines in place that encourage their engagement, and are avoidant because of the anxiety they feel about the work. And again, at Encompass, and what you guys can do is spin this around. Okay. Before we move on, I want to spend a little bit more time talking about that thoughts and feelings component, because I do feel that it's the piece that's most difficult to capture when we're talking about executive functioning and motivation. So at Encompass, we take a cognitive behavioral therapy methodology approach, which is just a fancy way of saying the way that we think and we feel affect our behavior, and our behaviors affect the way that we think and feel. So therapists, because CBT is a therapy method, they're really there to get at the root causes of thoughts and feelings, like what's driving those negative thoughts and feelings and what are healthy coping practices. But at Encompass, we're the behavior piece. We're almost like the actionable therapy because we understand that behavior affects thoughts and feelings. So think about it this way. Healthy people, wherever they may be, and not teenagers, their arrows flow in all directions. But people who have big feelings, this doesn't need to be disordered. This could be kind of typical teenage feelings, maybe overwhelm, some depression, some isolation, especially last year in COVID, shoots over to thoughts. What's wrong with me? Why is it easier for everyone else? And we just kind of buzz at the bottom of the triangle. Anxious people tend to start in the thoughts corner. For most students, it's anticipatory and performance anxiety. I hope I do well, make the grade, get into a good college, please this person, how am I going to do, how I'm going to perform? That anxiety just escalates, maybe some pre-existing negative feelings. And again, we're just kind of like buzzing at the bottom. We can't get up to behavior. So when we have big thoughts and feelings, and we're trying to get up to behavior, we cope with those thoughts and feelings in one of two ways. The first way, and kind of the more common way, is avoidance and procrastination. It's like turning away from the work. It's like, get that away from me. That is stressful. That makes me feel bad about myself. That makes me feel anxious. So avoidance is a coping mechanism that allows us to escape difficult thoughts and feelings. Kind of put more simply, when we're able to turn away from the work, it's no longer overwhelming or stressful. So it makes sense that we're just like, okay, well, this feels way better than that over there. The second way, and I think my slide's trying to go, is hyper-focus and perfectionism. This is the opposite. This is turning towards our work. This can look a bit like perfectionism and compulsion, placing so much emphasis on emphasis or value on an assignment, kind of intrinsically and extrinsically, like I got to do a good job and I hope I get the grade, not handing in work on time because it's not deemed good enough or we're not able to finish it. So I see this a lot where if students just handed in the work, they might get a higher score or there would be less friction or stress, but they just can't do it because it's not done yet. The idea here is that if we turn towards, we fix, maybe we won't feel those big feelings and thoughts over there because we're just going to work so hard that it will make that go away. So it's also a coping mechanism for negative thoughts and feelings, and it's also unhealthy. I think the tricky thing is this concept of apathy. Because, you know, I assess kids almost every day of the week, and I hear a lot from parents, like they just don't seem to care. They just seem so disinterested. I just wish they would do the work. And what we find time and time again in our assessments is that it's misleading. Most students that come to Encompass, like I said at the top, are bright, are cool, are smart, have things they're interested in. It might not be academic, it may be academic. And had been performing well, like up into a point, like maybe in elementary school or through middle school. And then they reach whatever age that is where the executive functioning part catches up with them. And then they have all those negative thoughts and feelings and they don't know what to do with that. So they might turn towards the work, but then it's overwhelming. And ultimately they just turn away from the work. So it's almost as if they want to work on it. They do care. They want to perform, but because they don't have the executive functioning skills and their self-esteem is probably starting to get eroded, it's just easier to turn away. But it's not that they don't care. So to be really clear, we can correct what presents as laziness or disinterest by providing students the executive functioning skills they need to engage and working on building a healthier sense of self-esteem around their work. But wait, if they care, wouldn't they just do the work? Like, I know this can sometimes sound so theoretical, and as parents were like, but they just really need to do their work. Like, why can't they do it? It would be so much easier. Let me explain. I want you to imagine that a level table, kind of like this, represents healthy engagement. This means that we have low stress, low anxiety. The table means confidence and low stress. We're able to engage. But then we get a task, an assignment, multiple assignments, big assignments, and it like slams on our table and tips us up and makes it really hard to do that work. I'll give you an example. I dread paying my electricity bill every month. I'm a grown adult, but I do not like paying my electricity bill. I just ran a Christmas tree for 6 weeks, or the AC is going, or whatever it is, and I just dread it. And so I might avoid it. We all do that. It is a natural coping mechanism to turn away from things that cause us discomfort. But I'm avoiding my electricity bill. The fallout, the outcome of that avoidance starts to take effect. I don't want to lose electricity. I don't want to get a ding on my credit score. And so I'm like, you know what? I didn't want to look at it, but ultimately I'm just going to do the thing because the outcome isn't worth it. So the outcome hits and it tips us upright and we engage. So to be very clear, it's natural to have some avoidance, but when we are kind of in a more healthy mindset, our table tips when the outcome of that avoidance meets the stress of the task. Where we know something's wrong, and we see this often with our students who seem to be self-sabotaging with their avoidance, is that we have the stress. I don't want to do the assignment. I don't know how I'm going to do it. I don't know when I'm going to do it. I don't know if I'm going to do a good job on it. And it just is like, oh my gosh, overwhelms us. And the fallout doesn't tip us up. The grades, the tension at home. And I think something we don't take, or I have to kind of remind people a lot, having been a classroom teacher, it is awkward for students to go into class and not have their materials, not know what's going on. So all of that, the grades, the tension, the awkwardness, it's not enough. It's not tipping it upright. In fact, it's going to slide down the table and just add and tip us and tip us and tip us and tip us. And the higher our stress, the harder it is to tip up. And so we just sit in it. So the other thing that can happen is that we'll sit in our avoidance. We'll sit in that avoidance. But sometimes the stress of that fallout, or like this, hits us real hard and we fling all the way up here into kind of manic engagement. It's equally unhealthy, but it's almost like this manic productivity, like all-nighters or working all weekend. It's like, I can't do it. I can't do it. I can't do it. Fine, I'll finally do it. I also want to remind us about that rigid and binary thinking. I'm either going to work or not work. That plays a big part of this. This is why so many students say that stress is a motivator, or people say they need deadlines to get their work done. They'll wait till very late at night to start their work. They'll wait to the end of the grading period is a big one we hear. It's like it's been missing for weeks, but finally the grading period's coming, so they get the work in. So this is not healthy either. Here's what we do at Encompass to mitigate this. We want to work on the other two pillars of motivation to reduce the stress and the overwhelm and to keep that table more level. So to be clear, it's natural. It's natural to be a little avoidant. It's natural to kind of like have bursts of productivity, but we just don't want these wild swings. So we need to prop up that third pillar with the other two. Healthy metrics of success and value systems and environmental supports. Environmental supports, this is about building resilience through clear executive functioning strategies. So instead of it's just, I have work, I have no work, I'm going to work in these spurts or I'm going to avoid all my work. The name of the game is to make things manageable, to break down large or multiple or varied tasks and responsibilities, again, into manageable components that we can proactively engage with so that we are able to engage. We have these environmental systems in place to make the work less stressful. The value system is equally just as important. I'm sure you've heard this, we hear this all the time. It's not a big deal if I don't. Or it is a big deal and now it's too much of a big deal. We have all of that negotiation happening. So we constantly are having conversations that teach, goal setting strategies to help students identify what's intrinsic and what's extrinsic and to make it healthier. So that maybe the goal is that we just don't have late work or we don't stay up all night, as opposed to I have to make perfect grades or get everything in. And then we have these intangible goals that add to stress. We have tangible goals with healthy metrics that reduce stress, because that's the name of the game, reducing stress. So kind of in summary about motivation, we have the value, we have the environment, and we have the feelings. Therapists really start with those thoughts and feelings. We're the other piece. So we're going to prop up our table by tying value into the work, creating a healthy environment to work with strategies in order to reduce that stress and to keep the table more level. Okay, so that was a lot about motivation. Thank you guys for listening. I want to switch gears and talk about the teenage brain and how this plays a role, because everything we've talked about so far, executive functioning and motivation, that's all of us. We all have to have executive functioning and to be motivated. But that teenage brain, it's a unique guy. So let's get started. I want to start with defensive behavior. It's the first thing that comes up with every parent. Defensiveness is, by definition, it's a coping mechanism for a lot of deeper anxieties and insecurities. It's like we're literally defending ourselves when we feel threatened. And slide will go. You know, defensiveness can be outward, like what we typically think of, like yelling, slamming doors, like, leave me alone. But to be honest, more commonly, it's inward. Shutting down, withdrawing, maybe also wanting to be left alone, but in a quieter way. It's just a defense mechanism, again, defending ourselves. So if defensive behavior is the behavior that we employ when we feel the need to defend ourselves, what exactly is so threatening, especially when you talk about school or chores or tasks and responsibilities? Excuse me a second, I'm getting over a cold. So think about it. There is a universe where you go to your child and you're like, what homework do you have? Did you hand that in? How did the test go today? When do you plan to get something done? And they have the answer to that question and it's not very tense and they're willing to talk about it. But, sorry, I'm back up. Because that line of questioning is very reasonable and very rational, there's a world where it gets met with a reasonable and rational response. But you're asking about behavior a lot of the time. So remember the top of that triangle. What are you going to do? How do you plan to do it? Did you get something done? It shoots right down to thoughts and feelings and is going to trigger all of that insecurity. So a lot of times we're met with an emotional response that I don't want to talk about it. Leave me alone. I've got it. So we want to reduce that defensiveness by kind of unpacking a little bit more about that teenage brain so we can understand it. So again, part of this defensiveness is like, why are they so sensitive to it? Like, why is it threatening? Again, we know the triangle piece, but like, why? This is because the teenage years are all about identity formation. I call this the data grabbing years. It's like, am I cool? Am I smart? Am I funny? Am I liked? Am I attractive? Like, am I popular? It's just at the age where we're figuring out who we are. This is where like teenagers go through like goth phases and whatever phase it is. They're like literally trying on identities. But because of that, it's going to make them especially sensitive because all of it feels like data coming to them. And to be honest, a little self-absorbed. You know, I've devoted most of my career to working with teenagers and young adults, and I love them, but they're not, by definition, due to brain chemistry, necessarily sympathetic or empathetic beings right now because they are thinking about themselves so much. And don't worry, they will outgrow it, as we all hopefully did, because ultimately we've gotten enough data. We know who we are. We don't need to be so grabby, and we can kind of relax. But in the meantime, while they still are teenagers, the top two places they're going to get their data are at school, kind of both socially and academically, and at home with you. So let's start about school. Any student's academic performance is tied to their identity because we are told, again, from a very young age, that if we are good at school and we are smart and we are respectful, all of this kind of comes from the school arena for the most part. And again, don't forget about that rigid and binary thinking. If I'm not good, I'm bad. So it's incredibly sensitive. And if we get negative input, we've just discussed negative thoughts and feelings exacerbate avoidance, which again becomes a very cyclical thing. So when it comes to school, kind of to be clear and to simplify, there's a lot of contradictory data they're getting. Now, I don't know much about anyone's social experience, but I do know that people with low executive functioning, again, are often smart, interested, engaged, intellectually curious. That's all good. But their performance is not mirroring that. There's a lot of contradiction there, and that can increase a lot of anxiety. Data grabbing in you, mom and dad. I know it may not always feel this way, but genuinely, your data means more to them than anybody else's. Unfortunately, this makes them more sensitive to you, probably a little bit more defensive towards you. And this is very natural because your role with them is also contradictory because it's complex. You know, your mom, your dad, your provider, your caretaker, your support system, you're also, you know, friend and roommate to some extent. Like you wear a lot of hats. So by definition, you're going to have contradictory data. Like they know they're safe. They know they're loved. But also there's a lot of friction about school and that's hard to manage. So this is why you might see them, again, being extra sensitive to you and being less sensitive to other people, because our data means a lot less to them and it's less complex. So when we work with students, we wear one hat. It is their advocate as an executive functioning specialist. So we can say a little bit more than you can. I know it may not seem fair, but it's really because you mean so much to them. So kind of getting to the actionable steps about what we can do to reduce that contradiction, to reduce that defensive behavior, because they are so sensitive. There are two topics that we want to be mindful of in order to reduce defensiveness. And just to recap, defensiveness is defending ourselves. So it's really how we're going to come off as less threatening. The first is conflating intelligence and engagement. I would say that 95% of parents that call us will say, but my kid is so smart. They're just like not doing their work, or they used to do their work, or they sometimes do their work, or they hyper-focus on their work. Their engagement is not healthy, but they're so smart. And then we'll have consultations where parents will say, you know, I just got in this fight with my kid, and I just tell them they can do the work. They're so smart. And this is wrong in thinking. So there are two halves of academic success defined intrinsically and extrinsically. The first is our ability to comprehend information. The second is our ability to demonstrate that comprehension by getting our work in on time, by showing up to test prepared, by performing in the classroom. Comprehension is where intelligence lives, and a whole bunch of other factors, our learning style, our learning differences, teaching style, environment like last year, aptitude, but intelligence and comprehension live here. Our intelligence has nothing to do with our ability to execute and function. That has to do with other factors and deficits and strengths and skills that can be taught. So the problem is when you say you're so smart, why can't you just do the work? Even though it's a nice thing to say, it sounds like a compliment. You create two singular anxieties. The first, maybe I'm not as smart as they think I am. And the second, maybe they don't know me as well as they think they do. And it can be very deep and very buried, but it doesn't feel good. And as we know, when we don't feel good, we don't engage. So here is kind of the actionable step for you. Tell your kid all day long that they're smart. Of course they're smart. Celebrate what their interests are. That is so wonderful. Just don't conflate it with engagement. I know you're smart. It's not up for debate. What I'm talking about is engaging with your strategies, using your planner and getting the work done. They're separate. The second topic, and we're getting to it, is grades, which of course is such a big topic when we think of academic performance and success, but it's very, very, very complex. I mean, even parents call me and they're like, well, I want them to make good grades, but I don't care if they make all A's, but I want them to go to college, but I know it's not the most important thing. And that negotiation is because grades have so much intrinsic and extrinsic value. And they're often discussed in a very, very binary way. It's like, I'm good, I'm bad. So when we talk about grades, and we typically are like, I know that you can make good grades. One, that's very vague, which is stressful for an ADHD brain. And two, it's probably not going to be motivating because it's going to add to stress. And as we know, stress and negative feelings decrease engagement. Here's another way to think about it. At Encompass, we have something called the magic number. We ask every student about this. It is this number that if they're above it, they're like, oof, I'm good. And if they're below it, you know, they're like, man, this is terrible. I need to get my grades up. It varies. It's like a Rorschach test across students. We have students who are very perfectionistic who are like 97, 92, 88, 82, 78 is a big one. The nines are tell us something. And so many students just say 70. As long as I pass, I'm okay. This tells us a lot about how students think about themselves and their ability to be successful or their value system. Grades don't matter. And we have like sixth graders talking to us about college. It's very difficult to pin down the value of a grade in a healthy way for someone with ADHD and anxiety. Let me back up a second. So we want our children to make good grades for a variety of reasons. But as for everything I just said, they're not often motivating. In fact, they decrease motivation. So what do? Just like with intelligence, we want to tie it all back to skill sets and strategies. It's less personalizing. So it's less about me and my ego and my feelings. It's did you do or not do? It's easier when it's actionable, kind of put more simply. And it's something that we can pinpoint when things go wrong, again, that aren't about them. Did you or did you not check your planner work at this time? And because as I was just talking about comprehension and the demonstration of comprehension, we know comprehension is rarely the issue at play for our students. It's the demonstration piece. So by focusing on the planner, by focusing on these executive functioning skills and strategies that allow them to get their work in on time and show up to test prepared and engage in the classroom, the grades will follow. So that's where we really want the emphasis to be. Okay, kind of keeping this train going and talking about you. Kind of real talk and tips about executive functioning and things that you guys can be doing in the home. So kind of to recap what we were just talking about and kind of a through line through this whole assessment, de-emphasizing grades. Again, I'm not saying that they're not important and that we don't as adults want to put value in them. But for so many of our students, it really is not a healthy motivator. So we want to focus on the preparation needed to be successful and executive functioning strategies and skills, which means we need to equip our students with the executive functioning strategies and skills. Again, they're not intuitive to them. They're not innate. They can't just do it. So, you know, whether it's with us at Encompass or different pathways, helping them cultivate these skills and build out the systems that they need to engage. And then encouraging a lot of personal responsibility, which is about setting healthy boundaries at home. We'll talk about that in just a second, but it's with those three things that we really see the best results happen in terms of motivation and engagement. When it comes to those healthy boundaries and personal accountability, the best thing that you can do, particularly for someone with ADHD and anxiety, is to be as clear and consistent as possible. Ambiguity is so difficult for that kind of brain. So I'd recommend taking what is probably implied right now, because every household has implied obligations like certain chores and certain expectations, and really write them down and say on an actionable basis, this is what I want you to see, to do. I'd recommend expectations around screen time and environment when they check their planner, when they're going to work, and really nail them down. And I want to kind of clarify one thing also. A lot of times when we set expectations, we're talking about an outcome and not an action. So no missing work is not a good expectation, but checking your planner every day is. Keeping your room clean, way too vague, that's an outcome. The action is making your bed, doing the laundry, the step that it takes that results in a clean room. So I would dialogue about what your expectations are, how many you want, and clearly define them. It's going to be motivating. I think that action-oriented piece is what I was just speaking about, but kind of making it more about the classroom instead of in these kind of vague terms. And I don't want to script the way you talk with your children, but these are just best practices. And so, you know, like, how's it going? How did you feel? You know, that's, they probably don't know how to answer that kind of question. So being specific, did you, you know, about the strategies that either make with us or that you guys have made at home in general, keeping it very action oriented. Again, I think we've talked a lot about de-emphasizing grades, but kind of my final piece is just having other goals. Like, what is it that they want to see? Having a dialogue with your child about what their value system and value metric is. And then these at-home routines to reinforce these expectations and these actions. Routines should not be at set times. That's way too rigid and is going to fall apart. You know, it's like you're 5 o'clock every day and then something's going to come up. But much more like right before dinner, right after dinner, 30 minutes after getting home, creating just some very mild routines. You know, I know a lot of these recommendations can be hard. We're all busy parents, but just even moving in that direction, setting 1 to 2 expectations, 1 to 2 at-home routines really can make a huge difference. So that's what I'd recommend for you guys at Encompass. You know, we start every relationship with an assessment. That's going to allow me and my colleagues to build out a matrix of services, not just to support your child, but to support you as the parent. So we have our traditional executive functioning sessions that teach those skills. We do lots of parent consultations. You know, as Denise mentioned, we're doing group collaborative workshops with therapists of parents with students with ADHD and anxiety. We do education consultations. This could be about 504 plans, IEPs, curriculum, college admissions, and then adult services. Because so many of us as adults have our own executive functioning challenges, and it's hard to support our children when we're struggling ourselves. So we have this matrix of support that we like to employ that would hopefully help complement the great work that you're doing at home. Okay, well, thank you very much for your time. It's been a pleasure speaking with you. I'll go ahead and stop my screen sharing.
Great, thank you so much, Jessica. We appreciate that. That is always very illuminating. I think, for me, it's always a good reminder to think about, as you mentioned, the actions, not the outcomes, right? You know, what can you clearly define and center on so that the kids understand the specific steps to move forward, you know? So I thank you so much for that. Yeah. So we can open it up to further questions if anyone has just a few, and if anyone wants to stay online and discuss after, any more private information that they might want to share, they wouldn't want on, we can do that. I think Roxana is on and can switch, or maybe Gloria, I'm not sure.
We're both on. I didn't know if you wanted me to go ahead and stop the recording. Does anyone have questions that they would like to share with the group and have recorded, or I don't see any hand. So I'm going to go ahead and end the recording here.
Great.
So
that way everyone who's on can still go ahead and ask their questions afterwards and have it in a more confidential nature. So we thank you so very much. Again, Jessica Shore with Encompass Tutorial. So I would highly encourage you all to reach out if you have any questions. And also, Jessica, will you make available to anyone who asks or even send it to me? And I can forward the slideshow that you provided.
Sure. No problem. Okay. So I saw a question just pop in. Do you want to stop recording just in case?